Now we are going to incorporate another economy. So instead of just one country, one economy, we are going to have a world that is composed by two economies, home and foreign. Always that we are going to talk about the foreign economy, we are going to use the asterisk, okay, to indicate that that information is for that economy. So two countries, two goods as usual. Let's say that is going to be cheese and wine. One production factor is going to be labor, where labor is going to be fixed by country, so each economy is going to have an amount of labor, but labor can move from one sector to the other sector inside of one economy. So we can have workers in the cheese sector that can go to the other and vice versa. So they can move between production sectors, but not across countries. Also, we are going to have a fixed productivity per labor. It's going to be fixed in terms of the specific sector and also in terms of the specific country. So that means that the unit labor requirement in the cheese sector is going to be for that sector and given a specific economy. So one economy is going to have a unit labor requirement for cheese, while the other economy, that amount is going to be different. And these, both of them are going to be different respect to the unit labor requirement of one. Okay, so it's sector specific and also it's country specific. That productivity, the way of see that productivity, the inverse of unit labor requirement, as you must know already. Also, we are going to say that perfect competition prevails in all the markets. So that means in the market of goods, cheese, wine, but also in the labor market. That is the production factor market. In this case, it's just for the case of labor. To see how it's going to be trade between these two economies, home and foreign, one strategy could be just look at the absolute advantage. Okay, absolute advantage is telling me who is the best doing something in a specific, okay? So to see that, the thing that we need to look is for the productivity or the unit labor requirements. So we are going to say that one economy has an absolute advantage in the production of one specific good when the unit labor requirement in that sector is smaller for that economy respect to the other economy. Because unit labor requirement is the opposite, is the inverse of productivity. Unit labor requirement is how many workers you need to produce one unit. So as lower is that number, it's because those workers are more productive. So that is one strategy. If we observe that the unit labor requirement of cheese is lower in home economy, while the unit labor requirement of wine is smaller in the foreign economy, it's easy then to say how it's going to be the trade. One economy is going to export cheese while the other is going to export wine. So each of them are going to focus in the production of one specific good. And just looking, the absolute advantage is going to be enough. The problem of the absolute advantage is that not always going to give us an answer, like this case. So let's say that for these two economies, home and foreign, the unit labor requirement of cheese in the home economy is smaller than in the foreign economy. But the same thing is happening for the wine sector. The unit labor requirement in the home economy is smaller than the unit labor requirement of labor in the case of wine, sorry, this should be wine, for the foreign economy. So in this case, for both goods, for cheese and for wine, the home economy has an absolute advantage. So if we just look at that theory, the theory is telling us that we are not going to see trade, but that is not true. In fact, we are going to observe trade. How is determined that trade? How we can be able to try to understand or realize how it's going to be the trade? The absolute advantage is not enough. That's why we need the comparative advantage. And that comparative advantage, that concept, is going to tell us how it's going to be the trade, which economy is going to specialize in the production of what. and what is going to be the export and the import for the economy. Because even in the case in which one economy is the best doing everything, like here, even in that case, trade is beneficial, so it's going to exist. We are going to find trade between these two economies.
So, as I said, the absolute advantage is good when you have one economy with the absolute advantage in one good, while the other economy has an absolute advantage in the other good. In that case, the absolute advantage and the comparative advantage converge, so the result is going to be the same. The problem is coming when you just look at the absolute advantage and you have one economy that is the best doing everything, like this case. Just following that theory, the conclusion is that we are not going to have trade, because under the absolute advantage theory, trade is just possible when economies are completely different. So the absolute advantage is per economy in one specific good, and not when one economy is the best doing everything. But in real life, the thing that we are observing is that even in the case in which one economy is the best doing everything, even in that case, both economies can benefit from trade. How is that possible? Because even in the case that you are the best doing everything, by sure you are going to be even better doing one of the two things. So the main idea that is behind, that is going to be the result of the comparative advantage, the main idea that is behind is that even in the case in which you are really good doing everything, the best result is when you just focus in that industry in which you are even better. So it's like, I'm going to see in which one of my two industry where I have an advantage, an absolute advantage, I have even a better way of doing things. To do that, to observe in that, we need the comparative advantage. And we are going to have then one economy that is really good doing everything, but even in that case, it's much, much better. The result when that economy focuses in that industry in which in comparative terms is even better. So one way of observing that is instead of just looking the absolute advantage, so the Unilever requirement per industry across two economies, like here, home and foreign, and then for the other sector, the wine sector, home and foreign. Instead of that, it's just looking that Unilever requirement in relative terms. So I'm good in both of them, but in relative terms, in which one I'm the best. So, if we have something like this, it's just an example, that means that this unit labor requirement, the relative labor unit requirement for the case of cheese, it's much more smaller in the home economy than in the foreign economy. The opposite is going to be the result if we change this, okay? We are going to have the opposite sign here. So that means that this unit labor requirement in relative terms for the case of the cheese sector is smaller in the home economy than in the foreign economy, and that is in relative terms. So now I'm observing how good I am in both sectors and looking in which one I'm the best in relative terms. So also you can observe this additionally as the opportunity cost of cheese. So that means that the opportunity cost of cheese in this economy is smaller than in the foreign economy. The conclusion is that this economy is going to produce cheese, given the fact that the opportunity cost of producing cheese, that cost eventually is a cost, right? So it's a cost of not doing the other thing, but it's a cost. So where the cost is smaller, the production is going to be higher. So given the fact that here the opportunity cost of producing cheese is smaller than in the foreign economy, we should expect that this economy, when both of them open, this is going to be the one that is going to specialize in the production of cheese. And vice versa, the other economy is going to be the one that is going to produce more wine. That is when the trade is open, the market is open, But before of that, we are going to start with the closed economy. And we also know that this comparative advantage or this opportunity cost of cheese is also equal to relative price of cheese. So how is that possible? Well, you already know how is the relation because we do that previously. But also it makes sense. This economy, we are observing that it's really good doing everything, okay? But it's even better doing cheese. The opportunity cost of producing more cheese is smaller than in the other sector, in the wine sector. So that is going to mean that this economy is going to produce, even in a closed case, so without international trade, that the production of cheese is going to be much higher than the production of wine. So the supply or the relative supply of cheese is higher in the home economy respect to the foreign economy, where it is more costly producing cheese respect to wine. So, because the supply is higher, as higher is the supply of something, lower is the price. So, the relative price of cheese in the home economy should be lower than the relative price of cheese in the foreign economy. And vice versa, the relative price of wine in the home economy must be higher than the relative price of wine for the foreign economy. Now, let's going to put an example. Here we have home. This is going to be our information for the home economy. The same thing we have here for the foreign economy. Okay, so home, we have that the unit labor requirement in the case of cheese is 1. So the marginal productivity of labor in that sector is just inverse, 1 where 1 is just 1. The unit labor requirement in the case of wine is 2. So the marginal productivity of labor for the wine sector is 1 over 2, so 0.5. Here we have the total amount of labor in that economy. Something similar we have for the case of the foreign economy. Okay, so the numbers are of course different. So if we want to draw that PPF, we need that relationship between the total labor that we have and the labor that we are going to use in each sector. Being that the sum of the labor used in the cheese sector plus the labor used in the wine sector must be always equal to the labor. So that is the PPF, when you are using all your labor, okay? So you already have that formula in previous slide. In fact, we can remember the fact that for the string cases is when you are just using all your labor in producing one specific good. With these 2 points, you are able to make the whole line because here is a straight line. So here you must know that this is the case when you are just producing wine. So that means that the maximum amount of wine is going to be the number of labor that you have in that economy divided by the labor that you need per unit of wine. So unit labor requirement in the case of wine. Here we have 120 units of labor. We know that the unit labor requirement in the case of wine is 2. That's why it's 60. In this case, it's going to be just 120 because the unit labor requirement of in the case of cheese is 1. So that means for each worker, you are going to produce 1 unit of cheese. If you just use all your workers in producing cheese, the maximum amount of cheese that you can get is equal to the number of workers because each worker is going to produce 1 unit, okay? And in the other case, you need 2 workers per unit. So that's why it's going to be just half this amount of workers. Something similar you can do in this case, here the amount of labor is 100, and in both economies, the unit labor requirement is 1. So that's why here we have 100, and also here we have 100. About the comparative advantage to see which economy is going to produce one good in exchange of the other. For doing that, just looking at that analysis, we can observe that the unit labor requirement in the case of cheese is equal in both economies. So for that sector, we don't have a real answer. But in the case of wine,
This economy has a lower unit labor requirement, so we should expect that this economy has an absolute advantage in the production of wine. Also, we can observe that just looking the maximum amount of each good that each economy is able to produce. When this economy is producing wine, this is able to produce more, so we should expect that here for the production of wine, this economy has an absolute advantage respect to this economy. In fact, that is the thing that we were observing previously, because this is smaller than this. So the marginal productivity of labor here in the case of wine for the foreign economy is higher than in the other economy. And also we can see for the other sector, we said that just observing the union labor requirement, it wasn't enough. We don't have an answer, but here we are introducing an additional effect that is coming from the amount of labor, because here we have more workers than here. So that's why we can get an answer just looking the maximum amount that you are able to produce in the case of cheese. So we can observe that this economy is going to be able to produce more cheese than this economy when it's just producing cheese. That is coming not for the productivity, but in this case it's coming from the labor, given the fact that both economy has the same unit labor requirement. Nevertheless, that is one way of getting the result. That is going to be also in this case the same results as in the case of the comparative advantage, but even in that case, let's going to prove that the comparative advantage is saying the same thing. To do that, we need the slope. The slope of these curves is the opportunity cost of producing cheese. You remember that the slope is given by this, the unit labor requirement of cheese divided by unit labor requirement of wine. Always is the unit labor requirement of this good over the unit labor requirement of this good. In this case, it's cheese versus wine. For the home economy, it's 1/2. For the foreign economy, it's 1. In which case is smaller the unit labor requirement? Here. So which economy has a comparative advantage in the production of cheese? This one. It's the result that we were expecting, because in absolute terms, also, this amount is higher than this, so this economy has an absolute advantage in the production of cheese. And what about the production of wine? It's just inverse number, so we are going to have the inverse result. So that means that this economy is the one that is going to have this comparative advantage in the production of wine. In fact, 2 is higher than 1. So that means that the opportunity cost of producing wine here is higher than here. So it's much better having this economy producing wine instead of having this economy producing wine. So we are going to observe that the relative price of cheese in this economy is going to be smaller than this economy. The relative price of wine in this closed economy is going to be smaller than the relative price of wine in this closed economy. When these two economies open to international trade, we should expect that this economy is going to export cheese in exchange of importing wine, and vice versa. Now, to see what is going to be the effect of international trade, we are going to start with a situation in which its economy is closed, so without trade, no trade in terms of international trade. We have here the home economy, the foreign economy. As I said, its economy can produce two goods, wine versus cheese. Okay? Given the amount of labor, given the unit labor requirement of each sector and in each economy, we have this PPF. Okay? It's the black line. So we're here. Is in the same place that the red line, okay? In both cases. So, as we observed previously, the maximum amount of wine in the case of the home economy is 60 units. The maximum amount in the case of cheese is just 120, and here it was 100 in both goods.
The red as I said, the black line is for the PPF. PPF is possibility. So are all the possible combination of good that we can produce given the labor that we have and given also the technology in that sector, because it's determined by the unit labor requirement, and the unit labor requirement depends on the technology of each economy in each sector. Okay, so the PPF, the red line, is talking about the possibility of that economy. It doesn't mean that in that place is going to be finally the production. Well, we are going to see that the production always has to be there, but we don't really know in which point, because we have many possible combinations. Then we were talking about the labor market, because it's not just important the possibility of production, also it's going to be determined by the production side. I mean, how these workers are making decisions about in which sector they are going to work. And that was coming from this relationship. We said that in an equilibrium situation, wages in both sectors are equal. So that means if wage, you remember wage, this is for the tea sector, wage for the wine sector. The wage was determined by your productivity, so your marginal productivity, which is 1 over the unit labor requirement, in this case of cheese, 1 unit labor requirement in the case of wine, multiplied, so that is the productivity that you are able to get, but in physical units, but your wage is monetary units, right? When you are getting your wage, you get money, not physical units. So that's why it was multiplied by the price of, in this case, cheese, must be equal when it is here, wine, the price of wine. So you can see that from here, we were concluding something like this. So where is going to be then the equilibrium in the case of the labor market? Always that we have something like this. In fact, this is the opportunity cost of producing cheese, what is the same as the slope of the PPF. So that's why initially in a closed economy, that labor market is going to be in equilibrium always that the relative price curve, in this case is the red one, the relative price curve is over the PPF. So in that case, all the possible combination of output are possible also looking at the labor market. And what about the demand? Because that part, it was coming from the supply part. We were talking about the production factors. In fact, here just labor. But what about the demand? The consumer decision. To introduce that, we use the indifferent curves. Okay? The blue line. So we have many possible combination of production, but given the demand, well, given the indifferent curves, we are going to have just one combination of good with the maximum utility, which is feasible, which is possible. Let's say that for the home economy, that point where we have the three lines, so the PPF, what is possible, the relative price, what is telling us that the labor market is in equilibrium, and the demand side in different groups, all of them are together. So that means that in a closed economy context, this economy is going to produce 30 units of wine and is going to consume 30 units of wine, and it's going to produce 60 units of cheese and is going to consume 60 units of cheese. Let's say that, for instance, for the foreign economy, we have the same in the supply side. So the slope of the PPF has to be equal to the relative price of cheese. So one over the other. And let's say that in different courses, for example, it can be in any place. But let's say that is here, in this point. So this economy is going to produce and consume 50 units of wine and 50 units of cheese.
Okay, so that is the equilibrium. This is just to remind you that this is also the same as saying that this is equal to this. Okay, it's just the same terms. So now we are going to see how it's going to be the effect of openness in this context, in which we have one economy with a lower relative price in the case of cheese. So opportunity cost of cheese smaller in this economy than in this economy. So if this scenario was a starting point when both economies were closed, the thing that we have is also this graph. What is that graph? This graph is going to represent the market of cheese and the market of wine in each economy at the same time. So I'm talking about the two goods at the same time. And when we are talking about the market of those goods, it's because we are talking about the demand and the supply. In fact, here we are going to have the quantity, but not just the quantity of cheese, also the quantity of wine. In fact, we have the relative quantity of cheese respect to wine. Okay, so of course here we are going to have the relative price of cheese respect to wine. Okay, so instead of just having two graphs, one per each good, we can put both goods in the same graph. What is going to be this green line? It's the demand. We are going to assume that consumers in each economy are equal, so the demand in each economy is the same demand. That's why we can have just one demand. So this is like the market of these two goods in one economy or in the other, but it's just inside of each economy. This is the demand, but also we have the supply. Before going to the supply, the demand, the slope of the demand is negative. That means as higher is the price, remember price is in the vertical. So higher prices is because we are up, up, up. Okay, we are going up. As higher is the price, the quantity, which is in the horizontal, is smaller. You see, this combination of points has a really high price and a small demand. And here we have a smaller price, a higher quantity demanded, which makes sense, right? So the demand always is going to have that negative slope. That means as higher is the price, lower is going to be the quantity demanded. In the case of the supply, it's going to be just the opposite. We are going to have a positive slope. So that means as higher is the price, higher is going to be the quantity supply per these two economies. This is the supply for the home economy, and here is for the foreign economy. You can see that the red line, I mean for the home economy, it's more in the right side than the other. Going to the right side, here we have the 0-0 points. Going from this place to that place, going to the right side means higher quantity. So for any price, we are going to see that the quantity supplied in the home economy is going to be higher. Why is that? How is that? Because we are talking about the relative supply of cheese. And we just told before that the home economy was able to produce more cheese than the foreign economy. In fact, we should expect that that relative supply is higher in that home economy respect to the foreign economy. The result of that is in a closed context when economies don't trade between each other, we are going to see that for the home economy, the quantity consumed and produced of cheese respect to wine is going to be higher than in the foreign economy. In fact, 60 is higher than 50. And we can get 60 over 30 must be higher than 50 over 50, which is 1. You see? Of course, the relative supply or quantity of equilibrium about the cheese respect to wine is higher in the home economy because the supply of that good is higher in relative terms than in the foreign economy. Also, at the same time, because the supply is much more higher, that's going to involve lower prices. So we should expect that the relative price of cheese in the home economy
always is going to be smaller than in the foreign economy. Given the fact that the opportunity cost of cheese here, so the comparative advantage of cheese in the home economy is higher than in the foreign economy, home versus foreign, as we were talking. Now let's see what's going to be the effect of international trade. When these two economies start to trade, the thing that we are going to observe is that there are going to be people here who now they are paying a price, a relative price of cheese, much more higher here than here. So that's going to mean that these people want to buy this cheese. Why? Because it's cheaper in the foreign economy respect to the in the whole economy respect to the foreign economy. And these people is going to buy more and more cheese, always that the price of cheese, the relative price of cheese, is smaller than one, or it can be higher than equal or higher than 0.5. But always that the price, the relative price of cheese is between those value, these people is happy with international trade. And we are going to have the inverse for the case of wine. These people, the relative price of wine is just inverse. So 1/5, so it's 2. While here, the relative price of wine is just 1. The relative price of wine is just 1. So these people is paying a higher price, a relative price of wine, respect to these people. So they are going to start to buy more wine from here and less wine from the foreign economy. Eventually, the thing that we are going to see is like the home supply of relative supply of cheese inside of home is going to be smaller. Why? Because part of that supply now is going to the foreign economy. It's like this line is going to that place. And vice versa. In the foreign economy, the relative supply of cheese is going to be higher. How is that? Because now it's not just the relative supply inside of the foreign economy. Instead of that, we have a relative supply that is coming from the other economy, the one that is called here home economy. Eventually, we are going to have just one unique relative supply. That means that the relative price of cheese now is going to be unique, and it's going to be the relative supply in international trade, international terms of cheese. Okay, so this is going to be the new, this is for, sorry, cheese, wine, and this is going to be the international one. What is going to be the meaning of that here? The thing that we are going to see is that the relative price is not going to be anymore 0.5 or 1. It's going to be something in between. Respect to this one, now the relative price of cheese is going to be higher, thanks to the fact that we have people from the other economy who is willing to pay 0.5 and even more. Until 1, they are going to be happy. So it's like the slope of this curve now is higher, steeper. But also it has to touch the PPF, and that is just possible in a point like this. So this is going to be the new relative price, a price of cheese in this case. What about the foreign economy? Now the relative price of cheese is not going to be so high, it's going to be smaller. So this curve, the slope of that curve is going to be flatter. But also it has to touch the PPF. Where is that point? This point. Here we are touching, but at the same time, the slope is smaller than the previous one. Okay, so this is going to be the new relative price of cheese in international terms. Okay, respect to wine. This is not really good. The graph, because this must be equal to that one, I mean the slope. But to make sure that you are able to see the change. That's why I make this so clearly flatter respect to the starting point, and this is steeper respect to the initial point. Okay, so the thing is, we are going to have a new relative price of cheese that now is going to be just one, and it's going to be the international one. In fact, the thing that we should expect is that the consumption, the relative consumption of cheese in the whole economy now is going to be smaller, while in the foreign economy they are going to consume now more cheese than before in relative terms. Why? How is that? Because in the foreign economy they are going to find a lower relative price of cheese, while in the home economy they are going to find a higher relative price of cheese. And the opposite is going to be true for the case of wine. Now we are going to see an example in which I'm going to give you one possible relative price of cheese. We don't really know what is going to be that point. The only thing that we know that is going to be between 0.5 and 1, it can be any. So I'm going to give you one possible relative price. I'm going to give you for that relative price the quantity demanded in the whole economy of one of the two goods, and then we are going to be able to get the final result. I mean, what is going to be the consumption of cheese and wine here, the consumption of wine and cheese here, and also we already know what is going to be the production. Where is going to be the production? Well, production is the point in which the PPF is touching the relative price curve. Here is just this point. So now we are able to see that this economy, the home economy, is going to specialize the production in doing just one thing. Which one? Cheese. While the other economy, here you have the PPF, because the PPF doesn't change, the new relative price curve, this is the only point in which both of them are together. So it's possible, just looking the possibilities that you have, given your labor and your technology, and also given the labor market, observing the labor market. This is the only point. So we already know that the only production is going to be in the wine sector for the foreign economy, and this is going to be the quantity that that economy is going to produce. The next point is determine what is the consumption, and then how one economy is going to export. In this case, cheese, in exchange of wine and vice versa. So now we are going to see how is the way of getting the consumption of each economy of the two goods. We already know what is going to be the production. We said that this economy is going to produce just cheese, where the maximum production is going to be the maximum production for that good is when that economy is using all the resources that it has in producing that good in which it has a comparative advantage. So it's going to produce 120 units of cheese, and where this was 100 units of wine. Also, we know that the relative price is new. We have, instead of having two relative price of cheese, we are going to have just one unit, one relative price of cheese in international terms, thanks to international trade. So that is going to mean that the new possibility of consumption now is outside of the PPF. Just keep in mind that PPF is talking about the production, the possibility of production given my current resources. But now, thanks to international trade, as I said, consumers are going to be able to consume more ahead than was constrained by the PPF. Okay? In fact, we know that the prices are different, and the relative price of cheese is going to be between the relative price of cheese in the home economy and the relative price of in the foreign economy. So let's say that the new relative price of cheese is 0.57. Okay, we don't have information to know where is going to be the actual new relative price. That information is something that I'm going to give you always, okay? The only thing that you really know or must know, sorry, is that that value must be always between those initial relative price, in this case of cheese, respect to the whole economy and the foreign economy each of them, okay? And it must be between that value. Let's say this value, which is higher than this and smaller than this, we also need to know, at least we need to have just one data for consumption, and then with that we are going to be able to get everything. Let's say that we know that this economy, the consumption of wine is going to be 40 units, okay? I have to give you that data because you don't know how is the, in different curves, you don't have enough information to get that value. So I'm going to give you that value. So that means that consumption that always is going to be over the new relative price also is in this point of that relative price. And also we know that consumption is coming from that relative price curve and the indifferent curve. So by sure here must be a new indifferent curve. We know that that indifferent curve is going to be a little bit more far away from this point. So we are going to get a higher utility respect to the starting point. Now we have the amount of consumption of wine in that foreign, in that home economy. We know that the production of wine is coming from the foreign economy. So that consumption is only possible if that economy is importing that good. And that economy is able to import something because it's also at the same time exporting. So it's like changing one good for the other. Okay, you can see that in terms of exchange, one good for the other. Also, it's true that you can see that in exchange of money. Okay, you buy something and you sell something and you use that money to buy other things. Okay, it's like this economy is selling cheese, get money, and that economy can use that money buying wine from the other economy. Okay, or just you can see that as an exchange of one good for the other. We know then that, and this is important, the relative price of cheese, yes, is 0.57, what means that given the price of one unit of cheese, given the price of wine, you are going to be able to buy 0.57 units of wine per unit of cheese, or given the price of cheese. Okay, but this is the number of units of wine that you can get per unit of cheese, and the inverse number is going to be the number of units of cheese that you can get given the price of wine. Okay, here we have that this economy is buying 40 units of wine, and that is because it's selling cheese, and we know that each unit of cheese is going to give me the opportunity of buying 0.57 units of wine. So if I know the number of units of cheese times this relative price of cheese, I'm going to get that 40 units of wine. So in fact, the thing that I really need to know is this value. I don't know how many units of cheese I'm consuming and how many units of cheese I'm selling abroad. And thanks to the fact that I know that I'm buying 40 units of wine, that is only possible if I'm selling this number of units of cheese. So thanks to that fact, I'm going to be able to know how many of cheese is exporting. And then I'm going to know how many units of that production of cheese is consuming at home. So, because this is multiplying, goes to the other side divided, and the result is this one. So the home economy, which is buying 40 units of wine, that is only possible because it's selling 70 units of cheese. Okay, so now I know that this number, this export. So here we are talking about consumption inside. So the difference between the total production, 120, minus the export, is going to be the home consumption. Because consumption, because the production, it has to be consumed inside or abroad. Okay, all the production is going to be consumed. If I'm selling 70 units and I'm producing 120, it's because I'm consuming 50 units. So now we know the unit of consumption of cheese. So we have that this whole economy is consuming 40 units of wine and 50 units of cheese. Is importing 40 units of wine and is exporting 70 units of cheese because it's producing 120 units of cheese. What about this economy? Okay, I know that this economy is producing 100 units of wine. I know that it's exporting, is selling to the other economy 40 units. So that means that the consumption of wine, it has to be the difference. So 60 units, let's say, for instance, over here. 60. Okay. So now I know that because I'm talking about consumption and the new relative prices are telling me what is the consumption possibility, I know that it has to be in that point, and also I know that the new indifferent curve, it's going to be over here, okay? It's going to be parallel to the initial one, but it's going to be a little bit more to the right side, so with higher utility, thanks to international trade. But what about this value? What is that? That is the consumption of cheese. I already know the consumption of cheese in this economy because I know how many units of cheese the whole economy is exporting. So if this economy is exporting to this one, this is not producing cheese. And it's buying is because that buy is consumption. So this value must be 70, okay? The final result is the thing that its economy is going to produce that good in which is really good producing. That economy has a relative higher technology for producing that, and it's using all the resources that it has. So its economy is producing the maximum of its specific good. And also we can see that now, thanks to international trade, the consumption is going to be outside of the PPF. The PPF doesn't change, so the production must be always over that line. That is the maximum production that each economy can get. But now, thanks to international trade, I mean, thanks that to the fact that each economy is able to specialize in that field in which it has a comparative advantage, now consumers are going to be able to get a higher consumption, a level of consumption that before it wasn't possible. Okay, so that's why we're going to be always outside and in a different course that is going to be a little bit more up and at the right side at the same time. Now we are going to see how is the actual way in which we are going to see how the new international relative price of cheese is configured. As I said previously, that data is going to be a data that I'm going to give you because you don't have the tools to get that value, okay? Nevertheless, we are going to see theoretically and using a graph how is that way of getting that new international relative price, okay? So we are going to say that because we are going to do the relative price of cheese, here we are going to have the relative price of that good of cheese, and here we are going to have the relative quantity of cheese respect to wine. Because we are talking about cheese, we know that home is the economy that has that comparative advantage. So we are going to focus on this economy as the supplier of that good, while the other is going to be the demand of that good, okay? So that's why we are going to have a supply curve and a demand curve and then we are going to get the final results, I mean the equilibrium situation in which the demand equals the supply. Okay, well, the supply, as I said, is coming from the home economy, and we know that when that economy is closed, so before international trade, the relative price, it was 0.5, while here the relative price of cheese, it was 1. And we know also that when that price, it was 0.5, so this economy was closed, the actual demand of that good, the actual supply, which is also the demand inside of that economy, it was, let me see, it was 60 units, okay, so that value. Because that was the production, and because it was a closed economy, production and consumption, it was the same value. But now we are talking about supply. So that was the total supply. So when the price was, the relative price of this was 0.5, the quantity, it was this one. In fact, it was any of this value. All of this was possible, being the maximum amount of production, that value. The maximum, because you also have, given that price, other options that are not efficient. So when you are not using all your labor market, then you can produce even less, but that is not really efficient. So that's why this was the final production. Also, we know that as higher is the relative price of cheese, we know that then that economy is going to produce more and more and more. You remember, instead of just producing 60 units, eventually it's going to be able to produce 120 units. So the thing that we must bear in mind here is, as higher is the relative price, higher is going to be the international supply of that good. So the slope is going to be positive, something like that. So here we have that relative supply. Okay, it's coming from supply. What about the demand? The demand was coming from here. When that economy was closed, that means that the relative price of cheese was 1. And in that case, the demand, the consumption of cheese was this value, 50 units, okay? So that's why I have here the 50 and the 1. So that was the demand, the quantity demanded. But also we know that as lower is the price, as lower is the price, the quantity demanded was higher, because now I don't have that restriction that was coming from really high prices. Instead of that, the prices now are smaller, so that means I'm going to be able to consume more, okay? Eventually, so this is the demand. Eventually, we already know that the final relative price of cheese, it was, in our example, 0.57, okay? So, but that is the way in which we should draw that market in a proper way. Nevertheless, this is just something theoretical that we are not going to use usually, okay? This part that is just a flat line, also this. Normally we are going to talk about the relative supply and the relative demand of each economy. And that is something that you already have in the previous slide, okay? But this is interesting because this is the way in which theoretically is formulated the actual new relative price in international terms. Now, to conclude, we are going to see the gains from trade in this specific model, where the only difference across the country comes from the technology in each economy for each sector. The thing that we have found is that the new consumption possibility frontier is not going to be the production possibility frontier. In fact, we are going to see that the capacity of consumption, the possibility of consumption, is going to be higher than that production possibility frontier. How is that possible? Because its economy is going to focus in the production of that good where their opportunity cost is lower. So that means its economy is going to produce just one thing, and that thing is the thing in which they have a comparative advantage. So they are going to be really efficient doing that specific good. And they are going then to trade between each other. So it's like you're going to have more production and in a lower cost, so lower prices. So we can see now we are able to consume more, and also the price of each unit is going to be smaller respect to the initial one, at least in relative terms. What about wages? We are going to see that wages are going to be higher. So that's why also people are going to be able to consume more than before. How was the wage? If you remember, the configuration of the wage is your marginal productivity, but this is physical units, and wages are monetary units. So that's why it's your productivity, what you produce, times the price of the thing that you are producing. So that means as higher is your productivity and higher is the price of the good that you are producing, then your wage is going to be higher. The thing that we are going to find here is that in general, wages are going to be higher. Also, we are going to see that, just take our previous example as reference. In the whole economy, that people who is living there, so that labor force, is going to be working just in the cheese factory, if you remember. Because the whole economy, in our example, had a comparative advantage in the production of cheese. So, we know that it's in that sector where the marginal product of labor is higher. So, because it's given that, thanks to that fact, we know that that economy is going to produce cheese because it's more productive than the other economy in relative terms, so in respect to the other sector. So as a fair sign, we can observe that this is the highest between these two, the marginal productivity. So in the case of cheese, instead of having two, we are going to have just one sector. As I said, we are just going to produce cheese, and that is going to be because the marginal productivity of labor in the cheese sector is the highest one respect to the other one. Okay, so this is going to be really high, and also we observe that initially in that economy the relative price of cheese was 0.5. But then, after, with international trade, the relative price of cheese is higher. It was, I think it was 0.53 or 56, I don't remember now really well, but it's higher. So that means this variable now, thanks to international trade, is going to be higher. So workers in that country are going to enjoy from a higher wage. And the same thing for the workers in the foreign economy, in the wine sector. They are going to produce wine because they have a marginal productivity of labor relatively higher than the other economy. So, given the two sectors, we are going to see that workers are going to be in that sector where the technology is better, and then that technology is going to make them more productive, and the money that they are getting is given their productivity. So this is going to be the highest one. And also at the same time, in the foreign economy, if you remember, in that economy, the relative price of cheese, it was the highest, right? But that means that the relative price of wine, it was the smaller one, okay? Because if the relative price of cheese respect to wine, this was for the home economy, it was 0.5, okay? Then the relative price of wine respect to cheese is just the inverse, okay? So this is 2. What about the foreign economy? It was the price of cheese, relative price of cheese respect to wine, I think it was 1. So the relative price of wine respect to
She's in the foreign economy is also one, because one over one, the inverse number is just one. You can see that here we have the relative price of wine. Initially, when the economy was closed in that foreign economy. Now, thanks to international trade, that relative price of wine is going to be higher. So it's like this variable is going to be higher. How is that? Because in that economy, they were really good producing wine. So the supply of wine, it was quite big. And that meant that the prices of wine in the foreign economy were smaller than in the home economy. When this economy opened to international trade, that economy, the foreign economy, is observing that there are consumers in the home economy that are willing to buy the wine even at higher prices. So that foreign economy is going to increase the price of wine until get a point in which the price of wine in each economy is going to be the same. Okay, so we are going to have one unique international price, so we can say. So this is going to be higher, this is the higher ones, so we can see that in weight terms, both economies are going to enjoy higher wages. The question here is going to be the same, the weights in home and the weight in the foreign economy? It doesn't have to be the same value. Why? Because it depends in the marginal productivity of labor, so it's going to depend on the technology on each economy, and also it depends on the final price of each good. So they don't have to be the same value. The thing that we are going to have is that inside of each economy, the weight is the same, and that weight is going to be higher respect to a situation in which the economy is closed. So respect to a closed economy, international trade in this model is going to mean a higher wages, higher welfare in this economy. What about the wage? Because we can say something. What about the wage in that economy that is so good that it has an absolute advantage in the two goods that can be produced in the world? In that specific case, where one economy is really good producing both food, though it's going to produce just one of them, because the main benefit is coming from the specialization always, and in that case is the comparative advantage, the rule that is going to tell us in which good that economy is going to focus or is going to specialize. In that specific case, we know that that economy is the one that is going to have the higher wages. Okay, so we are not going to be able to know the weights because we need more information for that, but at least we know that the economy that is going to enjoy the higher wages is going to be that economy with an absolute advantage in both goods. Why is that? As you remember, absolute advantage is telling us how is the productivity of labor in each sector. So we are talking about this. If we have one economy that has the higher levels, it can specialize here in cheese or in wine. It doesn't matter, because given the fact that that economy has an absolute advantage in both goods, that means that this marginal productivity of labor in cheese is going to be always higher than in the foreign economy. So, if it's producing cheese, the higher wage. Or if the specialization is in wine, it doesn't matter, because it also has an absolute advantage in the production of wine in that specific case. So that means that this value is higher in that economy respect to the other. So whatever this economy is going to do, by sure it's going to have the higher wages. When each economy has an absolute advantage in a specific good, so for instance, here was the case, home has an absolute advantage in the case of cheese, while foreign in the case of wine, we know that the wage is going to be higher with international trade respect to a situation of a closed economy, but we don't really know which economy is going to have the higher wages, okay? We know that they are going to be better,
But we know the weights are not going to be the same, but we don't have enough information to know which economy is going to enjoy a higher level of weight. But in the other case, by sure, that economy with the absolute advantage in the two production sectors.